This episode is brought to you by Black Butler, parody of the Phantom Hives, a Black Butler abridged series slash parody. And by the Saga Song of Beaglesaurus. The coolest skateboarding cyborg in America fights space wizards, a corrupt American government, aliens, and more nonsense. Thank you. Miss Saigon kind of has some mixed messaging. On one hand, it does demonstrate how the myth of American exceptionalism, particularly in the form of barging into other countries under the guise of spreading democracy, tends to have pretty tragic results. But it's still a story where the Asian female lead's arc is centered on her devotion to and eventual martyrdom for the love of a man who really, really doesn't deserve it. Anyone else wish that Kim and Ellen took joint custody of Tam and told Chris to go pound sand? But it does come by this odd mix of woke and problematic, honestly. Let's talk about Giacomo Puccini's 1904 opera, Madama Butterfly. Like La Boheme, this opera is adapted from an earlier work. Actually, a series of them. The earliest form of this story comes from the 1887 novel Madame Chrysanthemum by Pierre Loti, which apparently was loosely based on Loti's own affair with a Japanese woman in Nagasaki. American writer John Luther Long took Loti's book, mixed it with some stories of Japan from his sister, and wrote the short story Madame Butterfly in 1898, which in turn was adapted for the stage by David Belasco 2 years later. Puccini took the Long Belasco version, replaced the awful pidgin English with some genuinely fantastic music, and opera history is made. So here's how it originally went down. As the curtain opens, American naval officer B.F. Pinkerton is closing on his new Japanese house with the local marriage broker, Goro. Goro is also arranging Pinkerton's wedding to the woman who will share that house with him, a 15-year-old geisha named Chocho-san. Pinkerton is a girl-in-every-port type who's mostly doing this because divorce in Japan is extremely easy, but Chocho-san takes the situation much more seriously and has even converted to Christianity. A fact which causes her Buddhist priest uncle to curse the union and her relatives to disown her. The couple is still in honeymoon mode and doesn't mind much, but Pinkerton leaves shortly afterwards, and 3 years later Chocho-san is still waiting and singing frankly amazing arias about her husband's anticipated return, rebuffing the doubts of her maid Suzuki and Goro's attempts to marry her off to the wealthy Prince Yamadori. The American consul Sharpless arrives with a letter from Pinkerton, but his attempts to break what is obviously bad news are stymied by Chocho-san's unwavering faith and the discovery of her biracial child, Soro. The cause of Sharpless's unease becomes clear when Pinkerton arrives with his American wife, Kate, with the aim of adopting Soro as their own. Pinkerton is overwhelmed with guilt when he sees the care Chocho-san took in preparing for his arrival and can't bring himself to face her, leaving Kate, Sharpless, and Suzuki to deal with the fallout. Chocho-san agrees to give up her child if Pinkerton will come for him, but after everyone leaves, she takes her father's ritual seppuku knife and turns it on herself, dying as Pinkerton approaches the house calling her name. Probably the biggest difference between Madama Butterfly and Miss Saigon is the portrayal of the male lead. B.F. Pinkerton is very unambiguously a dick. He raises a glass to the day when he will have a proper American bride while in the midst of preparations for his current wedding. He declares his desire to chase and capture Chocho-san, even at the risk of damaging her, and he condescends to and frequently fetishizes her as the dutiful, innocent, and submissive bride, though the opera itself is kind of in his corner in this case. Miss Saigon shifts the dynamic of this doomed romance several notches down the creepy meter by turning the characters into star-crossed lovers torn apart by circumstance. Chris's feelings are sincere, and he's presented more as a misguided idealist who was unable to save Kim as he promised. It still glosses over his white savior attitude and how shitty this entire situation is to Ellen in an attempt to make him more sympathetic, but you can't argue his heart is in the right place. When it comes to how America is represented, however, both the opera and the musical are kind of all over the place. In both cases, American influence is a key component of the tragedy, whether it's Pinkerton's careless behavior or condescending compassion mixed with questionable military action. Yet ultimately, the fact that the heroine's son will be raised by Americans is presented as a net positive. This is especially pronounced in Miss Saigon, where Kim's noble self-sacrifice for her son's American dream comes right after an 11 o'clock number that satirizes that dream in a paean to crass materialism. Both stories end up coming down firmly on the side of what Ibram X. Kendi calls assimilationism, the idea that while people of color have been mistreated by white people, the best thing for them is to leave behind their culture and be adopted into white society. Surprisingly, the heroine's grand suicide was not a feature of Long's short story. There, Cho-Cho-San takes up her father's sword, but is ultimately distracted by her crying child and decides to run away with him rather than allow him to be taken from her by the Americans. This is more thematically consistent with the condescending manner in which Pinkerton and his wife treat her. But apparently a woman being able to move on after a selfish dude bro breaks her heart is the real tragedy.
I stumble into town, just like a sacred cow. Visions of swastikas.